Good afternoon and welcome to a packed Olympic Stadium München for the second leg of this exciting final. And here come the Germans now, led by their skipper, Nobby Hagel. They must surely start favourites this afternoon. They've certainly attracted the most attention from the press with their team problems. And let's now see their lineup. The Germans playing 4-2-4, Leibniz in goal, back four, Kant, Hegel, Schopenhauer and Schelling, front runners Schlegel, Wittgenstein, Nietzsche and Heidegger, and the midfield duo of Beckenbauer and Jaspers. Beckenbauer obviously a bit of a surprise there. And here come the Greeks, led out by their veteran centre-half, Heraclitus. Let's look at their team. As you'd expect, it's a much more defensive lineup. Plato's in goal, Socrates a front runner there, and Aristotle as sweeper. Aristotle very much the man in form. One surprise is the inclusion of Archimedes. Well, here comes the referee, Kung Fu Tzu, Confucius, and his two linesmen, St. Augustine and St. Thomas Aquinas. And as the two skippers come together to shake hands, we're ready for the start of this very exciting final. The referee, Mr. Confucius, checks his sand, and they're off. Nietzsche and Hegel there. Carl Jaspers, number seven on the outside. Wittgenstein there with him. There's Beckenbauer. Schelling's in there, Heidegger covering, Schopenhauer. And now it's the Greeks, Epicurus, Plotinus number six, Aristotle, Empedocles of Acragas and Democritus with him. There's Archimedes, Socrates, there he is, Socrates. Socrates there, going through. There's the ball.
We'll be bringing you back to this exciting contest the moment anything interesting happens.
Well, there may be no score, but there's certainly no lack of excitement here. As you can see, Nietzsche has just been booked for arguing with the referee. He accused Confucius of having no free will, and Confucius, he say, name go in book. And this is Nietzsche's third booking in four games. And who's that? It's Karl Marx. Karl Marx is warming up. It looks as though there's going to be a substitution on the German side. Obviously, manager Martin Luther has decided on all-out attackers. Indeed, he must, with only 2 minutes of the match to go. But the big question is, who is he going to replace? Who's going to come off? It could be Jaspers, Hegel, or Schopenhauer. But it's Wittgenstein. Wittgenstein, who saw his auntie only last week. And here's Marx. Let's see if he can put some life into this German attack. Evidently not. What a shame. Well, now, with just over a minute left, the replay on Tuesday looks absolutely vital. And there's Archimedes. And I think he's had an idea. Eureka! Archimedes out to Socrates. Socrates back to Archimedes. Archimedes out to Heraclitus. He beats Hegel. Heraclitus, a little flick. Here he comes on the far post. Socrates is there. Socrates, there he is. Socrates has scored. The Greeks are going mad. The Greeks are going mad. Socrates scores. But beautiful cross from Archimedes. The Germans are disputing it. Hegel is arguing that the reality is merely an a priori adjunct of non-naturalistic ethics. Kant, by the categorical imperative, is holding that ontologically exists only in imagination. And Marx is claiming it was offside. But Confucius has answered them with a final whistle. It's all over. Germany, having trounced England's famous midfield trio, Bentham, Locke and Hobbs in the semi-final, have been beaten by the odd goal. And let's see it again. There it is, Socrates. Socrates heads in and Leibniz doesn't have a chance. And just look at those delighted Greeks. There they are, Chopper, Sophocles, Empedocles of Acragas. What a game he had. And Epicurus is there. And Socrates, the captain, who scored what was probably the most important goal of his career.
So, gentlemen, there's one thing you'll notice about Nietzsche, is that he has this tendency to poke fun and insult other philosophers and other thinkers. He puts them down a lot, and people often find this really, really funny. He just, like, attacks people, and it's almost like he's, like, an angry dude, just, like, you know, spitting at everyone, putting everyone down, insulting everyone, insulting all the philosophers that we revere as great thinkers, and he's just incredibly dismissive about them. And it's, it's always an interesting study, because you're kind of like, all right, he's probably doing this to be funny on some level. I'm sure he had great crack writing all his passages, but then underneath it all, like, he is actually 100% serious. Like, the reason why it's so funny is because he does mean it on some level. And it becomes a very interesting question. It's like, well, what the hell does he, like, why is he judging, why does he hate them so much, why is he so mean, why is Nietzsche, naughty, nasty, screechy Nietzsche, so nasty, why is he so mean? Well, the reason is because he actually had a judgment standard, a criteria which he saw value in an intellectual, in someone as a thinker. Like, he really saw most philosophers which the West revered as simply not up to scratch, not good at what they do. he had, as you could say, he had taste for people like Heraclitus. He thought he was brilliant. And he said that Horace, the Roman poet, he thought he was brilliant as well. And he was somewhat dismissive of a lot of these more recent philosophers that came up, like Kant, who would have these really complex and obscure theories about morality or something like that. And Nietzsche is, and he taught me this, and I really, really took notice of this, Nietzsche would be way more honorable towards the idea of simple and sophisticated is usually better than smart and overcomplicated, because it's usually just a load of fog about nothing. Nietzsche really tried to install this in his writing style. You notice that he focused on aphorisms that would say more in a sentence than most philosophers say in a book. And that's a description, that's a proof of power, that's a proof of something very interesting, in that you just get it. You know, if you're able to do that, if you're able to say a lot with little, you probably get it a lot more than someone who needs 100 books or way too many YouTube videos to explain a lot of concepts and whatnot. So I guess I'm sort of getting called out here as well. Now, what's so important for you is that Nietzsche actually puts forth a program which you can use to actually build your character, your mind, your intellect, your ability to develop your most crucial thing, which is your ability to express yourself. And he does it in this sort of hierarchy. He starts off by saying the foundation for your ability to be a great speaker, a great articulator, a great thinker, is actually your ability to perceive the world properly, your ability to find the truth. And then on top of that, what happens is you have to have the ability to understand, to think about things. And then finally, once you have that foundation, you're able to express, you're able to become an artist, become a public speaker, become a writer, become a rhetorical genius, an orator, whatever you wish. But once you have these foundations, you're able to do this with such power that you will move mountains, you will change the world. And you know, Nietzsche is a testament to that. You can see that throughout his works, no matter what you think of the man, his technique, his philosophical technique was brilliant, and he had a lot of substance. On top of that, he had brilliant style. He was a fantastic writer, and he's intoxicating for that reason. And for some reason, even if you don't agree with him, he will make you think. And that's probably the greatest victory a philosopher can have, instead of coming at you and saying, this is the absolute ideology which you must follow. It's more powerful if you can at least show people new ways of looking at things. And what you will notice is that most people hate new ways of looking at things. Most philosophers, most thinkers, most intellectuals you'll come across in the world, even the revered ones, are just sort of stuck in the comfort zone. And they actually kind of get angry at you if you say, well, what about we look at things a different way? What about we have a alternate opinion or something like that? No. They will freak out. They'll be like, no, you must see things my way because I am right and I have the science on my side and appeal to authority and appeal to validation. But no skill at thinking. They get actually emotional about their arguments and whatnot. And you will find this in yourself, because this is the thing that's holding you back. I've spoken a lot recently about this idea of, you know, shadow work and the left brain and whatnot. And the big thing I've noticed that's holding the boyos back, holding the boyos and the boyettes back, is, you know, the world theory, the big ideas in their heads. The kind of, I know this and things have to fit into this little box that I have. And that's the way things have to go. And there's a huge amount of emotional charge in that. And they're in pain and they're like, please, this has to be real. This information, this idea, this theory I've made has to be the way forward. But they can't just let it go and maybe say, oh, how could I break everything I just built and look at it from another angle and play around and whatnot and be more fluid. And this is where Nietzsche does something very interesting, which is the ad hominem. He actually judges your thoughts on your character first, your ideas on your character first. He's always searching for that type of call out. And it becomes very interesting when he starts to paint a big enough picture that you can actually start to see two types of intellectuals. One, which is the virgin, anxious intellectual, and the other, which is the Chad philosopher who smashes with a hammer. And there is a criteria, there's a standard, there's a taste, there's a way of being which personifies both of these. And you definitely want to be the Chad philosopher who smashes with a hammer. And it all hinges on the idea of truth. It all hinges on the way that you approach truth. Now, like, what the hell does that even mean? That's sort of jargon stuff, yes? And it is. So I'm actually going to go back to Rome, and I'm going to talk about the Roman religion and the way they conceptualized the truth. They talked about the idea of veritas. They talked the idea of reality as veritas. What can be verified is the word that we get nowadays from this. Now, veritas was a goddess. She was a woman. She was a goddess. She was beautiful. And what's so interesting is that Veritas gave birth to the goddess Virtus. Veritas gave birth to virtues. Truth gave birth to virtue. Now, virtue for us is the sort of like be moral and follow the rules thing. Of course, the Romans had a different conception of virtue. That word has changed. Their conception of virtue was excellence and courage. Now, what does that mean? How is this supposed to interact? It's a myth, so it's kind of a little bit confusing at first. But think about it this way. Reality is a crazy thing. And in order for you to face reality, in order for you to face the truth, in order for you to face Veritas, you actually need to be brave. Reality is scary, you know? You go out into the real world and you meet a beautiful girl. And it's intimidating. You're like, oh, fuck, I'm gonna have to go talk to her. And what your mind will do, your mind will say, she's probably busy, or oh, I'm better than her, or she's better than me, or she's walking too fast, or she looks like she's in a bad mood or something like that. And your mind will rationalize. Your mind will rationalize you away from facing the truth. Your fear will create a story. All right, and then that story will protect you. It will keep you in your little prison. You're just like, okay, I don't have to talk to her. Whereas what will happen if you do the brave thing, what will happen is you'll actually have to, that little rationalizing mind, you'll actually have to put her to a side and say, shut the fuck up, I don't care. And then you'll have to go over and face that unbelievable kick of adrenaline that your body gives you that's trying to wake you up. And you have to say, okay, thank you, buddy. Thank you for the kick of adrenaline. Okay, I'm just going to go talk to her. And you might walk up and you might be a little bit nervous. You're like, hey, how you doing? I just saw you over there. I just wanted to come over and talk to you. And then she'll sort of be like, oh, look, another dude, but like he seems nice enough. And then you sit down and talk to him. She was actually, yeah, I was a bit kind of bored. I actually wanted to talk to someone, and suddenly it's all working out. And Veritas is rewarding you. Reality is rewarding you for being brave, for being excellent. Because in order to face reality, you have to be courageous and you have to be excellent. And those two concepts blended together is what virtue meant. Can you see the unbelievable sophistication of that idea? And guess what? It gets even deeper. Because you could not be a man in Roman mythology until you achieved virtue. Virtue was tied to this. Not virtue like follow the rules, but virtue is in face the truth. Face Veritas. Face Veritas with courage and excellence. And that's how you become a vir, a real man, is what how that would translate with us. Now that's amazing and so sophisticated and so simple because it is true to form. The beautiful girl out there, what you can do is you can rationalize and ignore it and be a coward and stay in your little box and stay in your little lane and live an unexcellent life, a cowardly life, and get nowhere. Or else you can be courageous and go. So this is like literally like pickup training now at this point. You can be courageous and go and face the truth. And then you will get rewarded with being more manly. It is a manly feeling. It is an incredible feeling to overcome fear. It is so empowering. Because when you overcome fear, even little scenarios like this, you are in this microcosm doing this little myth. You are facing Veritas. And so Nietzsche said, and this is very important to understand, when this little philosopher sits down and his whole life he's been avoiding facing the truth, he's been a coward, and he was the type of guy that let that rationalizing mind explain away what he needed to do, the simple thing he needed to do. Oh, here's this theory, oh, she's busy and all that. All he's doing when he's writing this book is just letting that rationalizing mind just keep talking. And we know that this rationalizing mind, these excuses that this guy made up not to talk to the girl, is actually a load of bullshit. Like, oh, she's too busy. How the fuck do you know? You're just saying that to avoid the pain because it'll be uncomfortable for you to do what you want. You're staying in your comfort zone. And what you do is your comfort zone is made up by rationalizations, this little prison you build yourself. And so what's happening is that these philosophers, they sit down and they just write out these rationalizations. They let that crazy, cowardly voice, they give it more power, you know? And it's even more interesting is that, like, you'll see these people, you know, go on Reddit and they'll have these, like, theories about how women work and they'll be explaining what's going on with that. And it's the same. It's like they have these theories about how reality works and it's all convoluted and elaborate and you spend hours looking through it being like, wonder what these guys are trying to say. They use a lot of jargon, yeah. Wonder what these guys are trying to say because, you know, they say it with such conviction. They say it, like, as if they actually know what's going on. I better take it serious because they say a lot of stuff and they use a lot of big words and they sound like they know what they're talking about. Yeah, I better take it serious. And then they keep saying, oh, but that Nietzsche guy, he was a nihilist. Oh, he was a postmodernist. Oh, fuck him. He doesn't know anything. He didn't believe in truth. But these guys, of course, they believe in truth. their truth. They believe in their rationalizations as the truth. They have no conception that the truth is something more fluid, like we're describing. It is something that is out there in the world that you have to go face. They want to think it is something that their rationalizing mind can possess. This is what a woman is. It's this sparkle of conceptions that I made while I was sitting down in the coffee shop not talking to them. The woman isn't some type of thing out in the world that you go interact with. It's femininity isn't something that is out there that you engage with. No, that's silly mythological nonsense. That's irrational nonsense. We are enlightened. We sit in our coffee shops, get high, avoid doing courageous things, and write about it. Write, just let our rationalizations keep talking. And these are the people that are the authority in your life, and they get to dictate what you think because you give them credence. And so Nietzsche is pointing to this and saying, stop. These philosophers, these revered, anxious, nervous, virgin intellectuals are nothing. You need a Chad. You need to be a Chad philosopher with a hammer. You need to crack this bullshit. Because these big palaces of rationalizations, they look beautiful from a distance. You see them and you're like, wow, that's such an elaborate, powerful theory. That's so interesting. And Nietzsche just sort of walks up. Oh, interesting, all right? And he takes out his little hammer and he just taps in it. And it's like, oh, fuck, that whole palace of rationalization, I wasn't made of stone. I was made of glass. And it crumbles. Suddenly you realize it's all bullshit. And this is what he's doing with his little aphorisms. He's just tapping palaces. He's like, where the fuck is the stone? What have we been doing for so long? Have we just been letting these idiots build up these complicated palaces? Bang, that one falls. Bang, that one falls. And then what you start to see is that if we are to ever go forward, we're going to have to start looking at ourselves and saying, we are no exception from this. The way these philosophers, and the reason why they misled us, is because they don't approach the truth. They think that they can possess the truth and put it in and put their rationalizations together and be like, I've got the truth. I know what the truth is. But Nietzsche's saying there's a whole reframe you have to take towards the truth. The truth is a woman out in the world that needs to be experienced. It needs to be understood. And you are still part of this process. Because like we said, that psychological conquest where you become a veer, become virtuous by facing veritas, that is actually something you must do if you wish to be an intellectual. You have to take this attitude that you cannot know unless you face reality. And that's a psychological thing. And you're struggling like the loser in the corner with the coffee who's rationalizing, and you're in pain because the loser is in more pain. He thinks it's his comfort zone, but it's actually him being depressed and unhappy and doubting himself versus the Chad who's relaxed and kind of very confident because he knows that there's no real need to be afraid because he's faced fear 100 times before and he knows that it's just an emotion that he can overcome. But this person who's never developed their character, faced fear or anything like that, faced their shadow, if you will, whatever the fuck you want to call it, if you haven't done it, you'll be this little coward building this palace, almost as if this palace is this secret attempt for you to, you know, build something pretty so maybe the girls come over and be like, oh, you wrote that really nice palace, oh, that really palace of rationalizations, care to go on a date, instead of you just taking the assertive thing and actually doing it yourself. And so you suffer because of your rationalizations, because of your bullshit, because of your left brain, if you will. And you, if you want to develop your character, if you want to become juicy, if you want to become good at thinking, if you want to do Nietzsche's rigmarole towards building this foundation, learning how to perceive reality, perceive the truth, see the truth, face the truth as its foundation, then learn how to understand how to think with the truth, and then learn how to actually communicate and articulate, become the artist, the writer, the person, the rhetorical public speaker, the orator or whatever, you have to start in this foundation and say to yourself, am I doing it? Am I developing my character? Or am I being a virgin creator, virgin intellectual, virgin anxious person? Am I the Chad philosopher with the hammer? Am I calling myself out? Am I smashing my own bullshit? And so we are going to talk about all this. This is what this whole spiel is going to be about. We're going to look into a couple of tweets Nietzsche left in his tweet storm called Twilight of the Idols, and how to smash truth with a hammer, how to smash with a hammer. We're going to talk about his three-step program called Smashing Truth, which is exactly what I said. He talks about how he would go about developing a young person to make them a strong and juicy person, how he would go towards developing character with people. This is so interesting, his response to the education system. Nietzsche on the education system. The whole system of higher education in Germany has lost what is most important, the end product, as well as the way to get to that end product. You see, education and cultivation itself should be the goal, not the Reich. That this goal requires educators and not prep school teachers and university scholars. They've forgotten this. We need educators who are themselves educated, elevated, and noble spirits, who prove themselves at every moment, who prove themselves by what they say and what they keep quiet. Cultured spirits, grown ripe and sweet. Not the scholarly bores that prep schools and universities offer as higher wet nurses to the youth today. Not counting some most exceptional exceptions the educators are missing. The first prerequisite for education is missing. And that is why German culture is in decline. One of those the rarest exceptions of all is my honourable friend Jacob Burckhardt in Basel. To him, above all, Basel owes its preeminence in the humanities. You see, what the higher schools of Germany actually achieve is a brutal breaking in with the purpose of making a huge number of young men usable, exploitable for service to the state with the least possible waste of time. Higher education, and the huge number, the masses. That is contradictory to begin with. Higher education always belongs to the exception. One must be privileged in order to have the right to such a high privilege. No great, no beautiful thing can ever be a common possession. Pulchrum est pacorum hominum. The beautiful belongs to the few. What is causing the decline of German culture? The fact that higher education is not a priority anymore. The democratism of cultivation that has become commonplace. Let's not forget that military privilege formally requires the overuse of the higher schools. And that is their ruin. You see, nobody is free anymore in today's Germany to give his children a noble education. Our higher schools are all geared towards the most questionable mediocrity in their teachers, in their teaching plans, in their teaching goals. And everything is dominated by an indecent haste, as if something were spoiled when a young man, 23 years of age, isn't done yet. Doesn't yet know an answer to the main question, which is profession. Which calling do you have, young man? Human beings of a higher type, if I may say so, don't like callings, precisely because they know that they are called. They have time. They take their time. They don't think at all about getting done. At the age of 30, when it comes to high culture, one is a beginner, a child. Our overfilled prep schools, our overloaded, stupefied prep school teachers are a scandal. To defend these conditions, as the professors at Heidelberg recently did, for this one may have motivations, but reasons there are none. Because the education system is about bringing out people who fit into the factory world of industries and jobs and whatnot. So the whole idea behind the education system is stuff people's heads full of information, almost like they're just designed to pull levers and say back to the people, you know, here's the information that you need to eat, digest, build this little palace in your mind, this memory palace in your mind, spill it all out, and then we'll give you a qualification which validates the fact, which tells you you're a good little boy, and then we'll stick you out in the working world where you'll do the exact same thing again. Your boss will come and be like, do this, 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 and this, and this, and you put that in your memory palace, and then you spit it back out again, and you smash all the keyboards, and that's your life. Whereas you, at no point anybody says to you, here's a hammer, here's how you smash down that little fucking palace of yours, and here's how you actually think. And you'll notice that all the winners, the entrepreneurs, the creative people, the geniuses and all that, they do all this weird stuff such as thinking outside the box, being imaginative, being creative. They're figuring, solving problems. Very, very interesting stuff, you know? And there's actually like a very formal way of doing that. There's a very, very well-known way of doing that. It's known as classical education. And Nietzsche even was big into it as well. He believed that we, if we want to bring the best, if we want to culture the population, we need to actually manifest that. And so Germany was going through this, like, obviously they're going through this problem where they were trying to collectivize the entire nation that they just made around about Nietzsche's time in 1870. That's when they consolidated the entire German nation together. That's when they put it all together. And so they had this situation where, like, how do we get everybody on the same page, you know? And they came up with the education system. And you might think, oh, typical Germans, collectivize. And it's like, look, you Americans, you British, us Irish, we're no different, because the second our elites saw this education system, they were like, excellent. This is exactly what we need. We need to get everybody on the same page as well, because we have the capitalist market. We have the factory jobs that we want to plug people into, just like I described. And so they took it on. They took on the Prussian education model, and they were like, brilliant. Finally, we won't have to deal with like all these people who are homeschooled and have like, you know, original thoughts and all that. Finally, we'll be able to just box everybody into these nice little categories and stick them into the part of the economy that we want them to be in. And so it's kind of like a universal struggle that was going on all across the West, because you have this tension where you need to organize society, and so you'll come up with simple commodified solutions versus how do you cultivate specific characters. One problem I had when I was younger is I was so impatient. I was so like, I have to be successful by the time I'm 22. And my mind was so crap. Like, if I produced anything publicly when I was 22, it would be an embarrassment to look back on. That would have been so bad. My problem was I was trying to force results way quicker instead of taking my time and getting them done properly. It's like that whole idea of the guy who was sitting there in the corner in his coffee shop building his little palace of rationalizations, and he would go over to the girl and he'd be like, I need it now and I need it quick. And she's like, weirdo, get away from me. Reality rejects you, because reality doesn't give a crap about what you want, your little needs, your little immature, you know, your little immature, shall we say, splurting too fast. She doesn't want that at all. Instead, what the Chad would do is go up and play and flirt and engage and spend time and make the dance happen and see it like a movie and have this sense of patience and perspective and really be about enjoying what's happening. And that's reality, and women way favor that type of vibe. They way favor that type of relaxed feeling, that type of, well, we have time, there's no rush, there's no pressure. I need it. There's none of that. And it's the same with your life. Why do you not universalize these principles? It's the same with your life. You're like, I need to have my purpose by the time I'm 21 and have my life figured out by the time I'm 25. And there's no sense of like, I'm a product that I'm going to have to work on for a long, long time. There's no sense of long-term perspective and patience. There's no sense that, like, even in the school of life that we engage in, because our colleges are so shit, even when you come out at 24 and you try three different entrepreneur things or something like that by the time, or three different jobs by the time you're 30, you still have plenty of time to start. Like, it's not a disaster by any means. And so the story I've told before, and I'll tell it again, is just, this is just perfectly captures it. The bull versus the immature find my purpose. The bullock. So the bull and the bullock come over up across a hill together, and they walk up, and then there's this big open field with thousands of cows, and they're all beautiful cows, big juicy cows. And the bullock's like, oh my god, 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 oh my god. Let's go down, let's run down, and let's fuck one of the cows. And then the bull looks at him and says, no, child, let's walk down and make love to all of the cows. Be the bull, boyo. Don't be the little bullock. Be juicy, have patience, have time and whatnot. Have that perspective with your mind as well, with your character development. Now, on top of that, think about his first principle that he's about to lay out, which is how to start this process. What do you need to learn to do first? You need to actually learn to see reality. You need to actually learn how to participate in reality. You can't actually develop your character at all. You can't develop virtue unless you can actually interact with reality. And if you're stuck building this retarded palace of conceptualizations, which your education system encourages, how are you ever going to come in contact with reality? You know this now. Like, there's so many people who are weak characters nowadays. They're not developed people because they've got engaged with this whole process. They've got wrapped up in this whole process of, like, build my palace as complicated as possible. But instead, we got to take an entire reframe. As we said, the truth is not your little palace that you can hold on to and be like, I've built this theory, I have the truth. The truth is something you have to go and interact with. It's something you have to go out and see in the world. It's something you have to figure out. It's something you have to actually experience. Something that actually requires you to crush that need for you to conceptualize and theorize about everything. It needs to crush your need to say that, like, you know, women are these set of theories, instead go out and actually interact with them and learn what women are through experience and that type of thing. And that requires a certain psychological trait, and that is the foundation of what we would call learning to see, learning to have perspective, learning to be fluid with your perspectives. You know, this is literally about, like, learning how to use your joints before you learn how to fight, that type of thing. Learning how to, the technique, the basic punches before you learn, you go in and learn how to actually engage, like, targeted punches and whatnot. These are foundations, and so Nietzsche is going to rip into it now. In order not to be untrue to my type, which is a yes-saying type, and deals in contradictions and criticisms only indirectly, only unwillingly, I will set forth, right away, the three tasks for which educators are required. One must learn to see, one must learn to think, and one must learn to speak and write. The goal of all three tasks is a noble culture. To learn to see, to accustom the eye to composure, to patience, to letting things come to it, to put off judgment, to learn to walk around all sides of the individual case and comprehend it from all angles. That is the first preliminary schooling in thinking. Not to react to a stimulus right away, but to keep in check the instinct to restrict and exclude. Learning to see, as I understand it, is almost what is unphilosophically termed willpower. What is essential here is precisely not to will, to be able to put off a desire, a decision. All unspirituality, all vulgarness is based on the inability to resist a stimulus. One has to react. One follows every impulse. In many cases, such a compulsion is already sickliness, decline, and a symptom of exhaustion. Almost everything that unphilosophical coarseness calls vice is simply this physiological inability to not react. A useful application of having learned to see. One will have become, as a learner in general, slow, suspicious, and resistant. It will be with a hostile composure that one will let strange new things of every sort make their initial approach. One will draw one's hand back from them, leaving all one's doors open, submissively flopping belly down before every little fact. A constant readiness to jump in and interfere, to plunge into other people and other things. In short, the celebrated objectivity of modern times is bad taste, is ignoble par excellence. And again, just more dazzling brilliance. Because you would expect him to have some type of rigmarole where he's like, oh, well, you know, read all these books or step by step doing all this stuff. No, instead he says the foundation for good thinking is strength of will, is a character trait, is the masculine ability to hold back. As I was saying, the bull and the bullock stand up on top of the hill, and the bullock has this urge, this desire to go and be with all the cows. And what happens is the bull gets the same feeling, but the bull has this sort of higher power inside of him, this more developed sense of will inside of him, and this little fire comes up where it's like, go and be with the cows, bull, and the bull grabs it and says, listen instinct. Okay, I don't disagree with you. I would like to be with these cows, but if we're going to actually succeed in this, you need to bow to me. I am the higher power here. I am the decision maker. And we're gonna take you, and we're not gonna let you burn out like you did when you were a kid, because I remember what that was like. What we're gonna do is we're gonna channel you, so you have energy for a long time, because there's a lot of cows out there, and we're gonna be very busy, and if we're gonna need anything, we're gonna need energy. And that's the same when it comes to stuff like the truth. You will have this urge, you will have, and you felt this before, to build your little palace and say, the truth is this, and categorize quick. Your left brain will do this, it naturally needs to. And you're like, oh, I need to categorize quick. Cool, I've grabbed the world, I understand the world. And then you'll start investing all this charged emotional energy. And you'll start making the palace complex and whatnot. And then strength of will, character, power, the Chad, what he'll do is grab that instinct and say, all right, look, you wanna decide that this is the way things are quickly, I understand. But we need to hold back. We are not a fake intellectual. We are a juicy, juicy boyo. We are going to hold back and just let Veritas reveal itself. We're going to be sort of silent and observant. We're going to pay attention to what's going on. It's like you think with girls that you need to go up and you need to like do stuff. But in some sense, one of the most important things, the same with sales, one of the most important things is actually just paying attention, figuring out like what you're talking to, who you're talking to. Like, is this person, what's going on in her reality? Who is she? Is she, like, what side of me does she want? That type of thing. Like, does she want me to be, like, quirky and weird like I usually am? Or does she want me to be a little bit more relaxed because she's kind of, like, intimidated right now? Like, what's going on here? It's the same with something like sales. You can't just try force stuff down people's throats. You have to sort of pay attention to the human you're interacting with, the reality you're interacting with. And you can't do that when you're nervous, when you're like kind of trying to jump to the finish line, these type of things. And so strength of will is the foundation of this. And that's a psychological trait that most people lack. And the virgin intellectual, as much as they will, you know, say, I am great because I've got this theory, they're usually pretty, pretty pathetic people. They have no strength of will. They have no intellectual strength of will. They have no courage. They have no ability to just do this one thing that's so hard for people, is accept that the world is crazy and difficult and hard to understand, and that they don't need to understand it in order to live in the world. That is such a difficult thing for people to understand, is that you don't need a totally coherent set of like perfect ideology or palace or theory in order to live perfectly fine in the world. That is not necessary. Millions of people throughout all of human history have got away with it. If you believe that science is the big thing, how do people survive beforehand? Were they just all in perpetual existential crisis, or were they absolutely just fine with whatever bullshit that they were believing in, whatever silly mythology they were believing in, be it Greek or, as you might say, Christian or something like that? Think about it. You don't need coherence. You know, and even then on top of that, coherence and truth seems to be something more you engage with. And maybe that's your whole problem. You're stuck in a framing problem, and you're never going to be able to break out of that framing problem unless you develop the strength of will to stop investing your emotions in your rationalizations and start observing the world coldly and calmly, allowing the left brain to die, allowing the palace the left brain is creating to crumble. And say to it, look, listen, left brain, you're going to listen to me. I am the master here. And so when you get that foundation done, Nietzsche will tell you how to think. You build that up. You build the ability to see things from different perspectives. You build this ability to hold back and not jump to conclusions and be vulgar and be like lower and be sloppy and be ugly. You develop the ability to think on top of that. Learning to think. There is no concept of this in our schools anymore. At the universities themselves, even among real scholars of philosophy, logic as theory, as practice, as a craft, is starting to die out. Read German books. Not even the most remote recollection of the fact that thinking needs a technique, a plan of study, a will to mastery. That thinking wants to be learned as dancing wants to be learned, as a kind of dancing. Who among Germans still knows from experience that refined shudder which light feet in spiritual matters sends through all of one's muscles? Wooden clumsiness in spiritual behavior, grasping with a coarsely grabbing hand, that is so German that foreigners take it for the essence of Germany as such. The Germans have no fingers for nuances. The mere fact that the Germans have been able to put up with their philosophers, especially that most misshapen concept cripple there ever was, the great Kant, gives you a pretty good idea of German grace. For we cannot subtract dancing in any form from noble education. The ability to dance with feet, with concepts, with words. Need I add that one must also be able to dance with the pen, that one must learn to write. But at this point, I would become a complete riddle for my German readers. And of course, the ability to think, not some set of logical theories, but way closer to the idea of art and dance and vibe and flirt and play. As I said, Nietzsche would look at something like logic the same way as we look at something like music theory. Perfectly reasonable and needs to be used. But it also has a perspective where it's about, the end result is not about being like totally like logical down to the rules of logic. It's more like these rules are foundational structures that we build a song on top of, you know? If you obsess about the music theory, it doesn't mean you're going to be a good musician. And being a good musician, as being a good thinker, isn't a lot to do with the ability to dance, to clash things up against each other, to play with tension. As I always say, steel manning is such a powerful virtue because it forces you out of the rigidness of thinking, which the palace, the left brain virgin palace, wants. It forces you into this perspective of steel man this perspective versus steel man this perspective. Let these two things dance. They might even be antagonistic. They might have an internal logic together. What are the first principles they're asserting, and how do I bash them against each other? And there you have it. There's the opera of the mind, if you will. And if you're not doing that, you're probably not thinking very well, because your little box is keeping you stuck thinking that truth needs to be possessed in this sort of stiff, silly way, and you're failing to achieve that. And Nietzsche often gives out about the Germans because they would have this propensity. A lot of the philosophers that he gives out about were these sort of like stiff, categorical people, the Kant and his categorical imperative. And Nietzsche's sort of saying, smash all that stuff, see a new way of seeing things, be more artistic. Why are we not more artistic as a people? We need to start pushing ourselves towards this. And of course, the Germans were brilliant cultural creators, but Nietzsche wanted to take it to a higher level. He was like, we need to have this primary focus. This is something great about us. This is something we need to develop in ourselves. And he gives it now to all of us. All of us can take this and say, well, he's giving us a logical program which we can develop our minds. And obviously, once you've got that, you got that thinking dynamic down, you're able to write better. So when I read these passages in screechy Nietzsche, my mind sparked. I was absolutely delighted because this was an articulation of something that I felt on a very visceral level when I was going through college. I did not like school. I felt that it derped me a little bit. It was a sort of derp mode situation, and I didn't quite understand it back then in an articulate way. I never enjoyed going to classes. I never enjoyed listening to all the people talk about, this is the information, digest this information. There was only one or two educators throughout my whole school career that I really engaged with. And towards the end of it, you know, I was going through critical theory and all that stuff. I was in college studying music and literature, going through critical theory, going through music theory and whatnot. And it didn't, it was like I had this creative spark inside of me, this massive reservoir of boyo juice that was trying to burst out and make something. And I felt that it was good, you know, I felt that there was this energy within me that wanted to create something, that wanted to actually put something out there in the world, to release this imagination of mine into the world. And I thought that that would be a good thing. Like, I don't know, I don't know about what moral good thing I could do. That's always a bit of an issue for people. But one thing I know for certain is that if I could bring out beauty, that's going to help the world, you know? And it's not even, like, that wasn't even the motivation. It's just sort of an instinct. There's this shining heart, this inner child, this divine creator. As Nietzsche said, you move from the camel to the lion to the child. That's the evolution of a man's soul. And that child, that creative child, the serious child at play, I know if I can release that, I'm going to bring something powerful and brilliant to the world, and helpful and sort of redeeming to the world. That's something that moves souls, you know, the same way as music and beauty and art always moved me. I wanted to move people in the same way, and I wanted to move myself by getting that out there, because it's an incredible tense feeling where you have all this energy and potential and desire inside of you, and you can't get it out because your mouth is not articulate enough, or your hands are not skilled enough to bring out sort of this strange wash of visions and emotions you have in the back of your mind. And this is like the problem that I'm going through. I'm there, like, struggling with this crazy stuff, being like, there's this giant world inside my head full of charged emotions and I need to get it out here. And most people are being like, derp the derp, 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 information derp, information derp, information derp, information derp. And if you derp the information, you get the A, and then you get the job where you will derp more information, and that'll make you happy. No, sorry, that will keep you from starving and give you a roof and all that above your head. And so that irked me, because it felt like the best part of me was not getting rewarded. It felt like the best part of me was actually getting sort of sidelined, and that drove me insane. And so eventually I completely went away from the whole education system. I just pushed myself away from it very instinctively. I didn't really understand any of the stuff, like Jordan Peterson saying, oh, they've all collectivized or they've all derped the education system. I didn't understand any of that stuff. It just very instinctively, it wasn't rewarding the best part of me. You know, my soul, my most treasured part of what it is to be a human, which is my creativity, my imagination, my will to make something, you know. And so I went and I literally just got out of there, and I went and I found individual mentors in the fields I wanted to do. I went and I found poets, and I was like, show me how to storytell. And when I found musicians, and I was like, show me how to make music. And I literally just went to them, very instinctively doing what Nietzsche was talking about, people who actually get into that procedure. And that's revealed a lot to me in the recent years, the way I look at my behavior back then. Because there's this, like, I was getting fed this information thing and making a lot of these mistakes where I was becoming the information guy who would go for the whole left brain palace, and that's really what it became about, and become like a intellectual and all that. And that was going to get me nowhere. And the things that always got me somewhere were taking action, actually trying to produce stuff, actually trying to create stuff. When I look at Nietzsche and Jung, I think that's all they're really saying at the end of the day, you know. Individuating for Jung seems to be something like just manifest that inner world in the outer world if you can at some point. That's generally what a lot of it comes down to. And the same with Nietzsche, like he's looking towards these artist tyrants, as he calls them, these great creators, as the redeemers of the world. This is what we need. We need a lot more of this stuff, and this is hard to find for most people. And the education system's not exactly rewarding that. And it's not some sort of evil thing. It's just the nature of the historical trend. We had the Industrial Revolution. Our populations boomed. We needed to get everybody on board with modern economies. We needed people to become literate. So people said, all right, well, what's the sloppiest solution to this big problem? What's the quickest and best solution we can manage to this problem? It's not perfect. It kind of derps people en masse, but it was the mass education system. Sadly, the mass education system had an interesting enough thesis. We can inform a lot of people, get them all on the same page. Sort of useful, sort of not that useful. Not great for individuality, useful for coherency of a society. And so that's what they try to do. But of course, the downsides are your human individuality, your human spirit, cultivating that. that, that's not going to get rewarded. Mass, it just does not work. These two things cannot compute together. And so me and you are in a historical challenge. And you might turn around and be like, oh, fuck the system. And maybe that's okay. Maybe it's okay to be like angry at the system. The system has gone derp mode. The schools from the lowest schools to even the highest schools like Yale and Harvard, all right, they're derp mode. They're doing some weird collectivist stuff that no one is really interested in. We're interested in cultivating our character. Look, we can still do this, you know? These principles are not unique. You actually can use these principles on yourself and get somewhere. I'm always talking about right brainify and anti-left brain and all that stuff. You can, if you actually just do it instead of informing yourself about it and then thinking about it more, if you actually do it, you will get results. I've been working with boyos on the back end, and we apply these principles to their lives, and it does actually work. It's just that you want to know about it and then not do it. That's the big thing. And so the big vibe going forward, and the way I'm thinking about all this stuff, is we have this brilliant opportunity where, okay, history kind of pushed us into the mass derp education system, and that's what happened. Now the internet has come along. See, I went to a derp school. I can't speak properly. The internet has come along, and it is brought us this the sort of solution to this, perhaps, or a solution to this, and that is the scaling of great educators. You see someone like Jordan Peterson, and he can speak to everybody now. Now, before, that was not possible. You had lots of low-quality educators and very, very few high-quality educators who could only speak to, you know, a couple of people at a time. And now we have this situation where you can get, like, you can scale that stuff a large amount. And, of course, this becomes very, very interesting, because that starts to point towards the idea that you're not limited by time, space. You know, you might have one good educator like I did in my education system growing up, but most of the rest of them are invaluable. Now you can actually go and seek out your ones specifically. And this makes us think more and more and more, is that, like, it's almost like the principles themselves, the attitude, the vibe, the approach is what is sacred. And if we can just get a community of people together who understand and value this approach and want to bring this approach to life. People talk about, like, save my West and all this stuff, and it's like, all right, it's a very complicated problem, I'm sure, but it shouldn't this be at the core? If the West is to mean anything, isn't it supposed to be this idea of we are the people who believe in that inner creative spirit, and we are the people who are trying to bring it out, because that's what created Rome. That's what created the Renaissance. It was the fact that we could do that, that we had that in us to be those creative type of people. You look at Da Vinci and Michelangelo, and this is what they had. They had this amazing ability to channel that creative spirit, and their time wasn't perfect. They had, you know, the church, and I'm sure people were very mad at the church back then for being derped and authoritarian. They still managed to achieve this, and so we are simply in our time where we've got our own set of problems and our own set of possibilities and opportunities. And of course, if we're going to think about this stuff correctly, we're not going to get all left brain and be like, everything has to be perfect before I start. No, instead we're going to say, this is the reality here, this is the situation, and this is how we can take a couple of steps forward and start pushing things in a more healthy and productive and juicy and rewarding direction for the human spirit, if you will. And so how do we do that? And this is what I'm thinking a lot when I'm talking about the boyos and the boyo university, because I think that what the boyos have captured is that divine child energy. I think we do have that, you know, and it's like, as Nietzsche said, the maturity of a man is when he can find the seriousness of a child at play. I think that's where we're at, because I feel that we're all men, we're all gents, but we have that youthful energy about us that so much lacks in these people who are up there being the serious intellectuals who are saying a lot of fluff about nothing, who can't really, like, peer into these problems, who are getting nothing done, who are, like, stuck in these outrage cycles and all this. What about this idea that we collect together people who want to release this great energy and actually get them connecting with each other, get the good talkers in contact with people who are running boyo businesses, get the graphic designers in contact with storytellers so they start producing, you know, animated films or something like that. These type of things. How do we facilitate all this? So this is when I'm talking about the boyoversity, and again, these things evolve and take time, and this might not even be the right word. It might change. Rome was not built in a day, neither will the boyoism either. But this is the kind of anchor, the root of what I'm thinking about. There's this vibe, there's this energy, there's this attitude that we all have, this inner boyo juice, this inner boyo power, this inner creative spirit, the divine child, and we want to bring it out. And there's a way of bringing it out that's what Nietzsche's talking about here with these principles, this attitude, this style of bringing things out. So when you bring this out properly, it has this creative style to it that you must honor, we must bow to. And this whole information guy way of being, this whole like stiff poor intellectual that most derps that most people who've been through the derp system have ended up as, is not in anything we want to be associated with. We want to move away from that. We want to move towards this high powered attitude, and we want to connect people who have this high powered attitude, because there's very few people in the world who have this. And putting those people who have it together, they're the doers, they're the people who get stuff done. That's really what I'm thinking about when I'm talking about all this Boyo Network, Boyo University, Boyo Tribe. And so if you want to find out more about all this, I will leave a link in the description, and I will leave one in the pinned comment at the top, which will take you to a page where you can fill out whatever criteria, whatever your main interest is, basically. So we'll have storytelling, we'll have character development with the Western canon, we'll have brand building, we'll have charisma, sales boyos, these type of things, and lastly, we'll have body boyos, people who are juicy and working out and whatnot, and maybe working with body practitioners in some sense. Now, in that page, it will explain to you exactly how we work with people in those facilities, because we're not something for everybody. Like, I'm not some fitness expert or anything like that. So that's not what body boyoism is about. This is specifically about, you know, the psychology of the body and how to understand the body and how you can work with people in that facility. So I recommend you go in there and read all that stuff and pick one of those. And then that will tell us what you're good at, in what way you want to be associated with people. Do you want to be hooked up with, you know, other brand builders, or are you a really, really good storyteller that wants to be hooked up with a graphic designer or something like that? And then we will tell you some common problems that we're often getting, which such as like perfectionism for artists and whatnot, how to get an artistic process down and nailed, what to do with situations like where maybe your family and friends aren't really that supportive of this inner creative thing, and how you like find winning teams and whatnot and separate out and whatnot. So go in there. As I said, there will be 5 options. A lot of people are selecting all 5, and that's fine. If you've got a broad amount of interest, that's absolutely fine. You can select all 5, but maybe try to think more about 2 or 3, because I guess if we go deep, that's better than going wide. Really up to you, but I'd recommend 2 or 3. And that is everything for today, ladies and gentlemen. As I said, description and top comment, pop in there. By all means, tell us what you're interested in so we can decide how to go forward from here. Thank you very much for your time, and as always, stay juicy.